بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبع الهدى. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters in Islam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower us with His mercy, with His blessings, with His tranquility, and increase us in knowledge of the Quran and the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Today, brothers and sisters, we're going to continue on talking about some of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beautiful attributes. And in our previous lecture, we talked about how Allah's attributes can be divided into two categories. The attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are related to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's that, Allah's essence and Allah's being, which are inseparable from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also the attributes which are related to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's actions and conditions and statements. And we finished up our last lecture talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beautiful and magnificent face, and how the believers on the day of resurrection, they will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we went on and we talked about how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has two eyes, and the different verses in the Quran that talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's eyes in the singular form, in the dual form, and also in the plural form. So today we are going to talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beautiful hands. Allah, our magnificent and exalted Lord, has two hands. But His hands are those that befit His majesty and perfection. They do not resemble the hands of the creation in any way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَةٌ غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَلُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُوا بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبَسُوطَتَانِ يُنْفِقُ كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. The Jews, they say Allah's hand is tied up, meaning that Allah doesn't spend from His bounty, but it is their hands that are tied up. And they are accursed for what they used to say about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in falsehood. But indeed, Allah's hands, both of Allah's hands, are widely outstretched and continuously granting the creation from His bounties and provisions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives from His bounties whom He wills. Allah, He also mentions in another verse in the Quran, talking about Allah's magnificent hand and magnificent hands. Allah, He says also in Surah Sa'ad, He says, قَالَ يَا إِبْلِيسُ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيْ. Allah, He said to Iblis, He said, O Satan, what prevents you from prostrating yourself to the one whom I've created with both of my hands? Talking about Adam, alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fashioned Adam and created Adam out of clay with His own magnificent hands. And we have a hadith which is related in Sahih Muslim, which talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hands, and that both of His hands are right hands. And the hadith was narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As. He said that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He said that the just ones will be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on thrones of light, at the right hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most Merciful, the Almighty, the All Glory. And both of Allah's hands are right hands. Those who were just in their judgments and in the way they treated their families, and those under their authority. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has fingers. But in no way do Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's fingers resemble those fingers from amongst the creation. They are fingers that befit His majesty and perfection. It was narrated in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud that a Jew came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he asked, he says, "O Muhammad, Allah holds the heavens on one finger, the earth on one finger, the mountains on one finger, the trees on one finger, and all creatures on one finger. And he says, I am the sovereign, I am the owner." So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled so broadly that his teeth could be seen. And then he recited Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's statement in the Quran, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِي, that people have not made a true estimation, they have not made a just estimation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the type of estimation that is due to him. And according to another version of the hadith, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he smiled in amazement of what this Jewish person said and smiled out of confirmation of what he said. So even the Jews know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has hands and has fingers, and that everything in the creation rests in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hand. And there's another hadith which was narrated by Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, may Allah be pleased with both of them, that he heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that the hearts of Adam are all as one heart between the two fingers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most Merciful. And Allah directs the hearts and changes the hearts and guides them as He wills. So then the companions, they said, "O Allah, guider of the hearts, director of the hearts, changer of the hearts, direct our hearts towards obedience to You." So, after talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has beautiful hands and beautiful fingers, and both of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's hands are right hands, we need to be reminded that any of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes do not resemble anything from amongst the attributes of the creation. And we will also find in the authentic hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a foot. Allah has a foot. And Imam al-Bayhaqi, in his book entitled Asma' wa Sifat, he mentioned a number of hadith which talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's foot. One of them, which has also been narrated in Sahih Bukhari in Muslim, on the authority of Anas ibn Malik, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, the hellfire will keep saying to Allah, "Are there any more people that You are going to put in the hellfire?" Until the Lord of Glory will put His foot on the hellfire, and then it will say, the hellfire will say, "Enough, enough, by Your glory." Then the hellfire will shrink and be extinguished and shrink into itself. And according to some narrations, it's mentioned that there will be extra space in paradise until Allah creates people for it and cause them to dwell in that extra space of paradise. And we find in another hadith, which is also in Bukhari and Muslim, which was narrated by Abu Huraira, which talks about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's foot, it mentions that Allah's Messenger said, "Paradise and hell engaged in a debate. And the hellfire said, 'I was created to take the arrogant and the tyrannical.' And paradise said, 'Why is it that no one will enter me except the weak and lowly among mankind?' So Allah," He said to the paradise, He says, "You are My mercy, by which I will show mercy to whomsoever I will from amongst My slaves." And He said to the hellfire, "You are My punishment, by which I will punish whomsoever I will amongst My slaves. Each of you will have its fill." The fire will not be filled until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts His what? Puts His foot. And the hellfire then says, "Enough, enough, enough." Then it will be filled and will shrink into itself. And Allah does not treat any of His creation unjustly. As for paradise, Allah will create people for it and fill the paradise with them. So Allah, not only does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have a foot, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has a shin. And it is obligatory upon every Muslim to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a shin. Okay, because He told us about it. As Allah talks about in Surah Al-Qalam, يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ. And remember the day when the shin shall be laid bare on the day of resurrection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's shin will be laid bare on the day of resurrection, and they shall be called to prostrate themselves to Allah, but the hypocrites will not be able to do so. And we also find hadith which are in Bukhari and Muslim, which talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beautiful shin, which was narrated in the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, where Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, our Lord will lay bare his shin, and every believing man and every believing woman will prostrate to him. There will be left those who used to prostrate in the world in order to show off and gain a good reputation. Such a person will try to prostrate, but his backbone will become solid. He will not be able to bend his back, and he will not be able to prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we must take note here, brothers and sisters, that affirming Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a shin is also like affirming that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a hand, and that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the ability to hear, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the ability to see, and all of the rest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes. And we have a narration from Ibn Abbas, who interpreted laying bare the shin as referring to the seriousness of the matter. And this actually contradicts what is proven from Ibn Mas'ud, that he said that our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala will lay bare his shin for everybody to prostrate to. Imam Ash-Shawkani, he said that Allah has given us sufficient interpretation of this ayah in the authentic reports from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger. And this does not imply thinking in physical or anthropomorphic terms, for there is nothing like unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Imam al-Tabari, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Ibn Kathir, they mentioned that just as they also neared the hadith which explained the text of the Quran, they did not interpret the hadith in any way different than its apparent meaning, which indicates that they did not see any contradiction between the hadith and the view of Ibn Abbas. The master will indeed be serious on the day of resurrection, and this does not contradict the idea that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will lay bare his shin. So now we'll move on to another characteristic of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is al-istiwa. Al-istiwa. Al-istiwa ala al-arsh. Okay, al-istiwa means to be raised above, or raising above and being above. Okay, and al-arsh, okay, al-arsh is the throne, okay, the throne, or like a bed of a king, like a bed of a king that a king sits on. And Allah, he talks about this in the Quran, in Surah An-Naml. Allah, he says, inni wajadtu imra'atan tamlikuhum wa utiyat min kulli shay'in wa laha arshun 'azim. Allah says, inni wajadtu imra'atan tamlikuhum wa utiyat min kulli shay'in wa laha arshun 'azim. Allah talks about in Surah An-Naml about an arsh. Okay, he says, I found a woman ruling over them, and she has been given all the things that could possibly be possessed by a ruler or a king on the earth, and she had a great throne. So the arsh of Allah, the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, is what Allah raised up above everything in the creation, and then Allah settled upon it and sat upon it, and it is his greatest creation. And Allah has specialized the throne with many beautiful distinguishing features. Number one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after creating it, he rose above it. Secondly, Allah made it to be the highest thing of everything in the creation. Thirdly, it is not from amongst the things Allah grasps and seizes on the day of resurrection. So elevation and rising above the arsh, rising above the throne, means raising and elevating upon the arsh without striking similarities, or without asking how, or alteration, or disabling of the texts or the meanings. And many authentic texts have been mentioned which prove the meaning of al-istiwa. Okay, that al-istiwa here, it means the elevation and the raising and settling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's magnificent throne. And the throne is the greatest thing in all of the creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to his throne in many places in the noble Quran. And Allah even praises Himself by mentioning His rising over the throne and by declaring that He is the Lord of His magnificent throne. From amongst these verses, if you open up the Surah Al-Taha, Allah He says, Taha, مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى إِلَّا تَذْكِرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى تَنزِيلًا مِمَّنْ خَلَقَ الْأَرْضَ وَالسَّمَاوَاتِ الْعُلَى الرَّحْمَانُ عَلَى الْأَرْشِ اسْتَوَى. Taha, these are the letters that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the meanings of. We have not sent down this Quran to you, O Muhammad, to cause you distress or to cause you difficulties, but we have only sent you this revelation as a reminder to those who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A revelation from Allah, who has created the earth and the high heavens, the most gracious, who has rose above His mighty throne in a manner that suits and befits His majesty. And Allah, He mentions in Surah Al-Hadid, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْأَرْشِ يَعْلَمُ مَا يَلِجُ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَمَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا وَمَا يَنْزِلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَمَا يَعْرُجُ فِيهَا وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. Allah, He says in Surah Al-Hadid, it is Allah who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and then rose above the throne. He knows what goes into the earth and what comes out of the earth and what descends from the heaven and what ascends up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with you with His knowledge everywhere, wherever you may be. And Allah sees everything that we do. And Allah also mentioned in Surah Al-Buruj, Dhul Arshil Majid. Dhul Arshil Majid, the owner of the glorious and the magnificent throne. Allah also mentioned in Surah Al-Isra about His magnificent throne, قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ مَعَهُ آلِهَةً كَمَا يَقُولُونَ إِذَا لَبَتَغَوْا إِلَى ذِي الْعَرْشِ سَبِيلًا. Then they would certainly have sought out a way to the Lord of the throne. And Allah even praises Himself as being the Lord of the throne, as we find in Surah At-Tawbah. Allah, He says, فَإِنْ تَوَلَّوْا فَقُلْ حَسْبِيَ اللَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ عَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْتُ وَهُوَ رَبُّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ. In Him I put my trust, and He is the Lord of the mighty throne. And Allah mentions in Surah Al-Anbiya, many verses in the Quran that talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's arsh. لَوْ كَانَ فِيهِمَا آلِهَةٌ إِلَّا اللَّهِ لَفَسَدَتَا فَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَرْشِ أَمَّا يَصِفُونَ. Glorified is Allah, the Lord of the throne. High is Allah above all evil that they associate with Him. There's many other verses. Inshallah, I'd like the students to go through the Quran and to gather up all the verses that talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's magnificent throne. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ghafir, okay, in Surah Al-Ghafir, Allah, He also tells us that there are bearers. There are those that hold His throne. Okay? And that we find in the hadith that Allah's throne is above the water. And Allah is above the throne and He knows everything that we do. And one of the evidences that informs us that the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is created is what we find in Surah Al-Haqqah. Allah says, وَالْمَلَكُ عَلَىٰ أَرْجَائِهَا وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ فَوْقَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانِيَةً. And 8 angels on that day of resurrection will be bearing the throne of your Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of resurrection. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also mentioned in Surah Al-Ghafir, الَّذِينَ يَحْمِلُونَ الْعَرْشَ وَمَنْ حَوْلَهُ يُسَبِّحُونَ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّهِمْ وَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِهِ وَيَسْتَغْفِرُونَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا رَبَّنَا وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ رَحْمَةً وَعِلْمًا فَاغْفِرْ لِلَّذِينَ تَابُوا وَاتَّبَعُوا سَبِيلَكَ وَقِهِمْ عَذَابَ الْجَحِيمِ. Those angels who bear the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those around it glorify the praises of their Lord and believe in Him and ask forgiveness for those who believe in the oneness of Allah. They say, O our Lord, You know all things. You comprehend all things in mercy and knowledge. So forgive those who repent to you and follow your way and save them from the torment of the blazing fire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us that his throne has bearers. And that even the bearers, they seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the believers. So this negates the view of those who say that the throne refers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sovereignty and dominion. Okay? According to a hadith which is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, when you ask Allah, then ask Allah for what? Al-Firdaus. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the best. For it is the middle of paradise. And it is the highest part of paradise. And above it is the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful. And from it sprung forth the rivers of the paradise. And in another narration we find in Sahih Bukhari, from the narration of Abu Huraira, that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, do not prefer me over Musa, for the people will fall unconscious on the day of resurrection, and I will be the first one to regain consciousness. And Musa will be there, holding on to the side of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's throne. I do not know whether Musa will be of those who fell unconscious and then woke up before me, or whether he was one of those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exempted from falling unconscious. So in another narration, another wording, we also have that Musa will be there holding on to the pillars of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's throne. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his creation, he wrote down with himself above his throne that my mercy precedes my wrath. So the throne is one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation, and it is one of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above his throne. Okay, Allah, from Allah's creation is the throne that Allah created, which is the best thing in the creation. And from Allah's attributes is the fact that Allah rose above his throne. Al-istiwa, that Allah rose above his throne. And Allah's essence is above his throne. So what is the meaning of istiwa? Okay, we don't know how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above the throne, because we don't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's essence. But we know the meaning of istiwa in the Arabic language. Okay? When the Arabs follow the word istiwa, okay, with a preposition, ala, istawa ala al-arsh, istawa ala, okay? When the Arabs use that istawa ala, okay, when they follow the word istiwa or istawa, and then they follow it up with the preposition ala, meaning above, it can have four different meanings. Okay, one, it can mean settling on, okay, like settling on the chair. For example, وضعت الكتاب على المكتب. على المكتب. I settled the book, or I placed the book, okay, over the desk. Okay, so in Arabic it can mean either settling on, going over, okay, rising above, or ascending. Okay, can mean four of these things, okay? Settling, going over, rising above, or ascending. Okay? So, Ahl al-Sunnah wal Jama'ah and the scholars of Hadith, they affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above his throne. We do not deny that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above his throne. But we do not discuss how it happened, because we don't know. All we know is that Allah rose above his throne. As for the specifics and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did it, then we don't have narrations from the Quran or from the Sunnah that explain that. And the scholars of Arabic language have narrated to us that the scholars whose fitra has not been contaminated with alien philosophy refuse to interpret istiwa as meaning istawla. Okay? Istiwa does not mean istawla. Istawla means to possess or take control of. Okay? And one of the earlier... okay, the earlier scholars of old, by the name of Dawood ibn Ali al-Isbahani, he said, I was with Ibn al-Arabi, and a man came to him and asked. He said, what is the meaning of the ayah? Right? Ar-Rahmanu ala arsh istawa, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above the throne. So Ibn al-Arabi, he said, he is on his throne as Allah told us. So he responded, he says, oh Abu Abdullah, does it mean istawla? Does it mean istawla, that Allah possessed or took control of the throne? So Ibn al-Arabi, he said, how can you know that? The Arabs don't even say istawla unless there are two people competing for a throne. Then whichever from amongst them prevails, they describe it as istawla. So this technique, which is acknowledging the meaning of istiwa, whilst not seeking to know how, is the method of the righteous predecessors. When Imam Malik, rahimahullah, was asked about the ayah, okay, was asked about the ayah when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is the meaning of istiwa? Imam Malik, he paused for a moment and he broke out into a sweat. Then he raised his head and he said to the questioner, he said, the most gracious Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above his throne as he described himself. We don't ask how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above his throne, because one cannot ask how with regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is obligatory upon us to believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rose above his throne. And you are a guild. You are upon innovation. And you are asking something which is going to lead you to greater and more serious innovations. And then Imam Malik ejected him from the majlis. And in another report, right, Imam Malik, he says, how is incomprehensible? How Allah rose above his throne is incomprehensible. Istiwa is not known, but belief in it is obligatory. And asking about how is an innovation. So the phrase, meaning that Imam Malik said, not known, okay, istiwa is not known, right, means, okay, or the phrase that he said, it's not unknown, okay, Imam Malik, he said, the istiwa of Allah, the raising of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above the throne is not unknown. Okay, so this means that it's known. And what is known is its meaning. Because the word has a meaning in the Arabic language, which the Arabs understood, and which scholars can explain and interpret. Hence, many of those who narrated the above view from Imam Malik narrated the meaning from him, and they mentioned that he replied to the man as follows. Right? He says, istiwa is known, but how is unknown. Believing in it is obligatory, and asking about it is an innovation. So in fact, there is no difference between saying that istiwa is known and saying that it is not unknown. That the meaning is the same. Qurtubi, he said the first generations, and specifically the generation of the companions, they did not deny anything with regard to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they did not say anything and related to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's istiwa, rising above, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, where is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where is his position. They affirmed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's place in the creation in accordance with what Allah had said in his book and what his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam has told them. And no one denies that Allah rose over his throne in a real sense. This only applies to the throne because it is the greatest thing in his creation. But we do not know how he rose over it, because we cannot know the true nature of this. And then he went on to mention the statement of Imam Malik. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created his throne and then rose above his throne, then this brings us to our next attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's highness. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is high and far above everything in the creation. He is the highest thing. Allah, he says, if qala Allahu ya Isa, inni mutawaffika wa rafi'uka ilay. Behold, Allah has said, O Jesus, I am taking you and raising you up to me. Wa rafi'uka ilayya. So anytime you raise something, this means that, okay, if you raise something to someone, that means that person or that individual, that being is up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised Isa to him, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above. Allah, he says in Surah An-Nisa, بَلْ رَفَعُهُ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَزِيزًا حَكِيمًا. Rather, Allah raised Jesus up to him. Okay. Also, Allah talks about the good deeds and the good words ascend to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is above the heavens. إِلَيْهِ يَسْعَدُ كَلِمُ الطَّيِّبُ وَالْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ يَرْفَعُهُ. To him, good words ascend, good deeds ascend, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates the righteous deeds to him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Mulk, أَأَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ بِكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فَإِذَا هِيَ تَمُورُ أَمْ أَمِنْتُمْ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاءِ أَنْ يُرْسِلَ عَلَيْكُمْ حَاصِبًا فَسَتَعْلَمُونَ كَيْفَ نَذِيرٌ. Do you feel secure from the one who is in the heavens, that he will not cause you to be swallowed up by the earth when it shakes? Or do you feel secure that he who is in the heavens will not send against you a wind casting down pebbles from the sky? That is that you may know the manner of my warning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about his highness, okay, also in Surah Al-Hadid. And we mentioned the verse earlier, verse number 4 in Surah Al-Hadid. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, another one of Allah's beautiful attributes is Allah's omnipresence. Okay, Allah's omnipresence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says that his knowledge, his understanding, his mercy, his forgiveness is everywhere. As Allah says, wa huwa ma'akum aynama kuntum. وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرٌ. And he is with you. Allah is with you by his knowledge wherever you may be. And Allah is the all-seer of what you do. And Allah, he says in Surah Al-Mujadila, مَا يَكُونُ مِن نَجْوَى ثَلَاثَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ رَابِعُهُمْ وَلَا خَمْسَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ سَادِسُهُمْ وَلَا أَدْنَى مِن ذَلِكَ وَلَا أَكْثَرُ إِلَّا هُوَ مَعَهُمْ أَيْنَمَا كَانُوا ثُمَّ يُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ. That there is no secret conference of three except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the fourth, and nor of five, but he is their sixth, nor of less or more, but he is with them wherever they may be. And afterward, on the day of resurrection, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will inform them of everything that they did, and Allah knows everything. And Allah said, addressing Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu in the cave, when him and the Prophet Muhammad were making migration, hijra to Medina, he said, لا تحزن إن الله معنا. Grieve not, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. Okay? Allah says in Surah Al-Taha, قال لا تخاف إنني معكما أسمع وأرى. Indeed I will be with you, indeed I am with you, hearing and seeing. And Allah says, also in other verses in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ مُحْسِنُونَ. Indeed, Allah is with those who protect themselves and with those who do good. Allah talks about he's with the patient ones as well. وَاسْبِرُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. So, when we look at the hadith, okay, when we look at the hadith, we have many hadith, okay. One of them we'll mention today is in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. In the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it says, when any of you stand up for prayer, you must not spit in front of you, nor to your right, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in front of you, but if you need to, you may spit to your left or under your foot. So brothers and sisters, Allah's omnipresence with his creation does not necessitate mixing with the creation and being embodied inside the creation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Most High, is above the heavens with us. And Allah is all comprehending of us with his knowledge, with his ability, with his governorship, and with his planning. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from all similarities. For example, someone saying, for example, I traveled and the moon was with me. This does not mean that the moon is mixed and joined with you, or sitting right next to you, or in your car with you. Also, the point of Allah being in front of you or in your face when you pray does not necessitate Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mixing with you or joining with you or being inside his creation with you. Rather, Allah is above the heavens and at the same time in front of your face. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from all similarities. For example, if someone said, the sun is in my face, you go outside, open your door, the sun is in my face. But it is not actually inside your face, but it is in the direction of your face, it is in the sky. Okay? And we have many proofs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's nearness. Okay, we mentioned some of them from the Quran, and we have many, many hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, many in Sahih Bukhari, Sahih Muslim. One of them is the saying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the companions raised up their voices in making supplication, the Prophet, he said to them, O companions, restrain yourselves, lower your voices, for indeed you are not calling upon one who is deaf or one who is absent, rather you are calling on somebody who hears. You are calling on somebody who is very close by. The one who you are calling is closer to each one of you, closer even than the neck that the camel that you are riding upon. So joining between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attributes of highness, being above, and Allah's raising above His throne, and Allah's omnipresence and nearness. Okay? Ibn Taymiyyah, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he mentions in his Aqidah Wasitiyah, he says Allah is above everything. And what we mentioned of belief in Allah included belief in what Allah has revealed in His book and what has been continuously reported from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's messenger and what the early generations of this ummah unanimously agreed upon. There was consensus upon this. That, and what did they agree upon? They agreed upon that Allah the glorified is above His heavens on His throne, exalted above His creatures, and that He the glorified is with them wherever they be and knows whatever they do. And Ibn Taymiyyah, he summed it up, okay? He summed this up, and then he went on to mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's statement in Surah Al-Hadith, verse number 4, that Allah is the one who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. Then He settled upon the throne. He knows what goes into the earth and what comes out of it, and what descends from the heavens and what ascends to it, and He is with you wherever you are, and He sees and knows everything that you do. So the statement in this verse, He is with you, Allah is with you, it does not mean that Allah is commingled with the creatures and human beings, okay? The Arabic language does not indicate this, okay? And it is against what the earlier generations, okay, the righteous predecessors of the Muslims agreed upon, and contrary to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's creation of all things. For example, once again, the moon is one of Allah's signs, to be found amongst the smallest of His creatures. It is placed in the skies where it is at the same time with both the traveler and the non-traveler. Wherever they are, the moon is with that person or that creature, whether he's traveling or not. And Allah, the Most Glorified, is on His throne, watching over His creatures, ruling over them. This is as well as other signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's lordship. So all that Allah the Glorified mentioned, okay, that He is on the throne and that He is with us, is true. Okay, it's true in itself and does not warrant any distortion, but should be protected from false conjectures, such as thinking that the apparent meaning of His saying in the heavens means that the heavens contains Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is invalid and totally incorrect. Okay, and this is right. What the righteous predecessors have consensus upon, and the peoples of knowledge, and the people of true faith. Okay? Included in this is the belief that He is very close to His creatures, meaning that Allah responds to His creatures, as He has mentioned in Allah's statement, okay, in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 186, that if my servants call upon me or ask about me, then tell them I am very close and I answer the call of the invocator and the one who calls upon me when he calls and supplicates to me. Okay? So what has been revealed in the Quran, in the Sunnah of Allah's closeness and Allah's omnipresence does not contradict with what has been told of His exaltedness and His highness and Allah being raised above everything. Glory be to Allah, there is nothing like unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is high in His names and near in His highness. So that was the summary of what Ibn Taymiyyah had mentioned in regarding to Allah's nearness and closeness and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's elevation and being elevated. So now we want to mention some of the ideologies of some of the Islamic sects in regards to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's highness and istiwa and rising and being above his throne, and also Allah's nearness and omnipresence. Okay, we'll start off with the view of Ahl al-Sunnah wa Jama'ah. Ahl al-Sunnah wa Jama'ah, as we've been mentioning, we establish and affirm that Allah's highness, okay, is above everything, and Allah's being and essence is above all things. Allah's essence and Allah's being and Allah's self is above his magnificent throne. And as regarding Allah's nearness and omnipresence, we say that Allah in his essence is above everything, and that Allah's omnipresence in creation is with his knowledge, and his nearness to his servants is with his knowledge, his guidance, and Allah's protection and mercy and forgiveness. We have other sects which emerged after the time of the Prophet Muhammad and after the time of the companions, who fell into some misguidance regarding Allah's highness, okay, his istiwa, and also regarding Allah's nearness, such as the Jahmiyyah. Okay, the Jahmiyyah, they deny Allah's highness. They deny that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has risen above his throne, and the law is above his throne. So they deny that. And they say that Allah is not in the world nor outside of the world. Okay, they say that Allah is not in the world nor outside of the world. And they say regarding Allah's nearness and omnipresence, they say Allah is not in the world nor outside of the world. So they don't know if Allah is close or Allah is far. So they deny the clear-cut, decisive texts from the Qur'an and from the hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which mentioned Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne, and mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is close and near to us. And as for, okay, some of the Sufiyya, they establish Allah's highness, okay, and Allah's being above and rising above the throne, but some of them, they say that Allah is everywhere in his essence. Okay? So they say Allah is above his throne. They establish that Allah is above his throne, but they also say Allah is everywhere in his essence. Okay? Many of them, such as those who believe in Wahdat al-Wujud, that Allah is everywhere and embodied in everything from amongst the creation. Okay? This is a misguided type of belief, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in his essence, he is above the throne. Okay, Allah fi nafsihi wa bi nafsihi is above the throne, but his knowledge, his understanding, and his protection is here in the creation with his servants. And also we have, right, another misguided sect called the Najariya. Okay, Najariya, they deny and negate Allah's highness and above his throne, and they also state, similar to many of the Sufiyya, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is everywhere in his essence. So we talked about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ascension and rising above. Now we want to move on to talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's descension. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ascended above his throne and sits above his throne, but also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends. Okay, he descends. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions this in a beautiful hadith, which is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, where he said that our Lord, the most glorious Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he comes down every night. Allah descends every night from his throne to the nearest heaven when one third of the night remains. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he asks, "Who is calling upon me so I can answer him? Who is asking of me so I can grant him what he asks? And whoever seeks forgiveness of me, then indeed I will forgive him." So this beautiful hadith this shows us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends, but it also shows us the love and the concern that Allah, the most magnificent, the most powerful, has for us weak and deficient slaves. So take advantage of this, brothers and sisters. Wake up during the last third of the night and call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so He can give you from all of your needs and fulfill your wants and desires of everything that you need in this world and also in the next. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come, okay? Allah will come on the day of resurrection, okay? So we have Allah's ascension, Allah's descension. Allah descends to the lowest part of the heavens in the last third of the night, but also Allah comes and goes wherever He wills. Allah, He says in Surah Al-Baqarah, هَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَأْتِيَهُمَ اللَّهُ فِي ظُلُلٍ مِنَ الْغَمَامِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ وَقُدِيَ الْأَمْرُ وَإِلَى اللَّهِ تُرْجَعُ الْأُمُورِ. Do they wait for anything other than Allah that He should come to them in the shadows of the clouds and angels? Then the case would already be judged and to Allah return all the affairs. And Allah mentions in Surah Al-Fajr, وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ وَالْمَلَكُ صَفًّا صَفًّا. And your Lord comes with who? With the angels in one row after the next. So this establishes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes. Okay, Allah will come to the believers and come to those whom He wants to go to on the day of resurrection. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also, okay, will move wherever He wills, whenever He wills, however He wills. And we have a narration from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the day of resurrection, He will gather together the first of the creation and the last of creation for an appointed term for 40 years, when they will be looking up at the heavens, waiting for judgment by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be passed, and Allah will come to them in the shadows of the clouds from the throne to what? To the kursi. Allah will come in the shadows of the clouds from the throne to the kursi. So today, brothers and sisters, we talked about some of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's beautiful attributes. We talked about Allah's throne and what is related to Allah's throne, that Allah rose above His throne. Okay. And we talked about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's descending and ascending and coming. And in our upcoming lecture, inshallah, we're going to talk about Allah's, okay, Allah's life, Allah's sustainment, and Allah's eternity, okay, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remain forever. And then we will go on talking about Allah's power, might, and strength. And then we will talk about other type of attributes of Allah, such as sifat al-fi'liyah, okay, that proof for attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, right, actions, okay, sifat al-fi'liyah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless all of you and all of us from what we heard today, and grant us understanding of the religion. As our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Man yaridillahu bihi khayran yufaqihu fi din," that whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants goodness for, He gives him understanding in the religion. So we ask Allah to give us proper understanding in the religion and implementation of it. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to purify our hearts and our souls and adorn our statements and our actions with Islam and with Iman. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.